Thanks very much, Jeff, and thanks to everybody. Thanks to Panos and Dipanjan and everybody involved in organizing. It's really a pleasure to be here. I think this is a wonderful symposium, and I think really covers a variety of diverse perspectives that are so important for our patients. So what I would like to do is, you know, since it's late in the day and we've heard a lot of detail, I thought, you know, I would go in a slightly different direction and maybe focus a little bit more, bring the discussion back to the patients and the goals of some of the analyses and the detailed biology and biochemistry that you've heard about today. And in that context, give you some vignettes about work in progress and some of the phenotypes that we've uncovered together with our collaborators in the setting of BRCA1 and 2 mutation carrier individuals. These are my disclosures, none of which are relevant to anything I'm saying today. So one of the challenges in seeing patients with BRCA1 and 2 mutations, which is essentially the entirety of my clinical practice, is the question about breast cancer prevention. And this slide highlights in ways that you may not appreciate the challenge that these women face. And so this is the age-associated penetrance from, see, age 30 to age 80. And one of the things that often is not emphasized is that if you, your average woman with BRCA1 or 2 between age 35 and 65 or more, the age-associated risk of breast cancer is relatively linear. And what that means for that woman is that her annualized risk of breast cancer is about the same when she's 35 as it is when she's 65. So a woman who is facing the question about whether to undergo preventive mastectomies, for example, it's not the case that she can say, well, most of my risk is later in life, so definitely I can wait and have the surgery, or the case that, you know, most of my risk is now and I need to have the surgery right away. It's really a quandary because age-associated risk is relatively stable for so much of the woman's lifetime. And so what's really missing in the field, for example, is near-term risk markers, right? Phenotypes and clinical biomarkers that might be able to tell a woman if, in fact, tumors are going to be arising in the next 5 years and not 20 years from now. But there are no such markers currently. And that's part of the goal of some of the work I'm going to talk to you about in the long term. So in terms of how we frame this, and you've heard a lot about this today from a number of the speakers, genetic studies, tissue studies, tumor studies have really focused on cells in the luminal lineage in the mammary gland as the targets for transformation related to BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations. As you know, the tumor phenotypes for BRCA1 and 2 quite distinct, with BRCA1 giving rise to about 80% triple negative breast cancers and BRCA2 about 80% hormone receptor positive breast cancers. Inferred to mean that there is a slightly different target cell in the luminal lineage for transformation and potentially different paths for pathogenesis, but nevertheless, the focus on the luminal lineage. You know, just to put a finer point on what the really, you know, how many of the unresolved questions there are, you know, you can see them here, right? When we're thinking about multi-step cancer pathogenesis, we really don't know what step the cells undergo loss of heterozygosity, which is probably required for loss of homologous recombination that we've heard a lot about today. What are the permissive genomic events that must occur prior to LOH and which may have to occur post-LOH to give rise to invasive cancer? And how might those be hallmarked by transcriptomic changes that could be turned into biomarkers? Either clinical biomarkers of near-term risk or even cancer prognosis. And then finally, underlying all this is the knowledge that understanding early pathogenesis is likely to inform prevention and also risk assessment approaches. So one of the ways that I wanted to frame the discussion is how some of the information I'm going to be telling you can be ultimately transformed into ways to affect care and ways that we can test some of the hypotheses in the most meaningful way possible. And in the setting of the breast, we have a unique advantage because of the accessibility of breast cancer. And in fact, ironically, because of the necessity for many women who have BRCA1 and 2 mutations to choose to undergo preventive surgery. And the idea is that even though this is a relatively rare population, these women, in my experience, are incredibly willing to enter clinical studies. And one of the long-term goals of our work and that of our collaborators is to be able to enter these women in studies where we've come up with good hypotheses, safe pharmacologic approaches to test these hypotheses in a rapid way in women who have, for example, chosen to undergo surgery in what's known as a window of opportunity trial, where a woman receives a short exposure, women already has chosen to undergo preventive surgery, undergo short exposure to a pharmacologic agent, and then one can assess the effect of that pharmacologic agent on the tissue at the time of mastectomy. And conceptually, this is similar to a clinical trial that we did, although this was in the BRCA-associated cancer study, but nonetheless, a window of opportunity trial that we did, we published last year, which was employing a single-agent PARP inhibitor, in this case, niraparib, in women with BRCA1 and 2-associated breast cancer, as the very first therapy given as a single agent. And the trial design was that the women would receive only two cycles of the agent, so kind of a window, and then subsequent therapeutic decisions to be made based on what the radiologic results of imaging by both MRI and ultrasound was. And so on the right, you can see the waterfall plot for the responses that were seen after only two cycles of niraparib therapy. And you can see the degree of shrinkage here and the radiologic assessment, which correlated roughly with the ultrasound assessment. And then ultimately, based, as I said, on the clinical decision making, 17 patients received 3 to 6 cycles of niraparib, 6 of whom underwent subsequent preoperative chemotherapy. Of those patients who only received niraparib between 3 and 6 cycles, 40% of them actually had complete disappearance of the tumor at the time of surgery. This is particularly important because in the setting of triple-negative breast cancer, for example, the ability to clear the breast of viable tumor cells is highly prognostic and confers greater than 90, in many cases greater than 95% chance that the patient is permanently cured. So the idea that with no chemotherapy whatsoever, which would otherwise be the standard therapy, you could clear the tumor of viable breast cancer cells, I think provides important biological information about niraparib. And you can imagine that this is also fertile ground for a lot of the types of studies we're doing in many drug settings where we can look preoperatively and postoperatively at the response and understand response, resistance, and evolution in this context. So this, again, just to bring it all back to the patient, is a setting that we think is going to be very fertile to apply some of the concepts and hypotheses in the setting of potential prevention approaches where we can reverse some of the phenotypes that are observed. So what are those phenotypes? A number of years ago, we wanted to ask that question and started a program where women who were had chosen to undergo preventive surgery, were asked if they would participate in the study where the tissue that would otherwise be discarded could be examined in the laboratory. And so this allowed us to do a variety of important studies, and clearly in this endeavor, technology has been our friend. The technology is evolving extremely rapidly to allow us to do more and more, to see more and more, and to understand more and more what's happening in the precancerous stage, and that's the focus here in women without a diagnosed cancer. One of the first and most simple things we did in this case series was just to simply sort the cells into, by simple FACS analysis with a two-marker system to look at the epithelial cells, where you could stratify and subset cells into basal epithelial cells, mature luminal, now called hormone sensing cells, luminal progenitors, now called luminal secretory cells, but these three kind of canonical subsets of epithelial cells. And what we found was that in the BRCA carriers, particularly here, this is focusing on the BRCA2 carriers, that there was an age-associated relative increase in the luminoprogenitor population relative to the basal population. You can see it here for the LP cells, here for the basal, and then, you know, more powerful when you do the ratio, because that corrects for certain technical factors. And so an increase in LP to basal ratio in an age-associated way selective for the carriers. And this indeed had actually been reported in other studies where they looked in a kind of ad hoc way that by and large BRCA2 carriers had a lower proportion of basal epithelial cells. So there did seem to be some phenotype. The most clear-cut finding that we observed, however, in our first study was through a collaboration with the late Angelica Amon, who had established some techniques for single-cell low-pass whole genome sequencing in her laboratory, and we focus on the luminal progenitor cells and basal cells for that analysis. And some of the results are what's shown here, and you've seen, I think, some of these sorts of plots with the single-cell whole genome earlier today, where each row is the genome, where the gray in the middle is the diploid genome. The genome here is along the x-axis, and so doing the low-pass sequencing, you can observe losses and gains. And so what we observed quite clearly was a series of losses, sometimes involving whole arms. Here's the here's a whole arm of chromosome 16 loss, whole arm of chromosome 1p gained here in these individual cells. And this was done at the level of individual cells. Most of these were not clonal alterations. It looked to be sort of a field effect of damage in subchromosomal aneuploidy in these early cells. I didn't say it, but these were all tissues that were deemed to be histologically normal by expert breast pathologists. And then in some of the cases, you could see what appeared to be emergent clones where multiple cells shared the same specific subchromosomal loss. And this is the picture that summarizes the first couple hundred cells that we sequenced, and so a number of take-home points from this analysis. First of all, this dramatic difference in the prevalence of these losses here that are all boxed here. You can't see the individual cells, but they're all here. So the boxes, all the different losses in the BRCA2 carriers, virtually none, less than 5% of cells in non-BRCA carriers. That the prevalence of these losses and gains were higher in the luminal cells, up to 30%, than they were in the basal cells, and that the predominant pattern was more losses than gains. But again, a relatively clear-cut and, I would say, unexpected phenotype. When we then went on to ask the question about what's happening in terms of LOH, it appeared, to the extent that we could evaluate it at the single cell level, that LOH had not occurred in the cells that had undergone this damage, suggesting this was indeed a haploinsufficient phenotype in these cells. And then we asked whether any of this could be recapitulated from these primary cells in culture. And therefore, this was work done by Mirabon Karivaz, and she took the individual cells and did a classical comet assay where you run an electric current through and damaged cells with broken DNA form a comet from broken DNA that then can be observed. And here under replication stress that we've heard a lot about today, you can see a comet more frequently occurring in BRCA2 heterozygous cells. Again, these are primary histologically normal cells straight out of the patient, but more common in the mutants than in the wild type, and associated at least on bulk RNA sequencing of surrogate cells in bulk cells with somewhat of a signature that had been previously reported to be associated with a defect in replication stress response. Of course, we are not the only ones who are looking at replication stress response defects in the setting of BRCA mutation, but then Mirabon went on to ask whether this was associated with any defect in the response to replication stress at the level of the checkpoint. And here again, primary cells straight out. These are not multi-passive sort of cells, but really primary cells in a culture that enriches for luminal progenitors because of low attachment conditions. And here she's standing for phospho-check 1, again in the setting of hydria, nucleotide depletion for replication stress. And you could see a defect in check 1 activation in the setting of replication stress, here quantified for hundreds and hundreds of cells in the the setting of a mutation carrier for BRCA2 versus the wild type cells. So all pointing to some defect in replication stress, potentially related to the DNA damage that we observed in the unmanipulated cells. And so then we turn to the models and have been working over the past few years with Ashok Venkatraman now at Singapore, and also Li Zhou, used to be a Mass General, now at Duke. And Ashok has had, of course, a long interest in BRCA2, and his particular interest was in trying to sort out different phenotypes of BRCA2 from different missense mutations. And here, I'm using this slide to make a slightly different point. And this was the idea that a mutant of BRCA2 that was a not a complete loss of function mutant, but a hypomorphic mutant, Ashok could show that this hypomorphic mutant appeared to have a selective loss of fork protection activity conferred by BRCA, but not in homologous recombination mediated repair. So I'm not showing the HR assays that he did, but just some of the summary of the fiber assays that he did to assess for fork protection. What you can see here is the replication tract length in the fiber assay. And of course, in wild type, you get the long tract. With complete knockout or full loss of function mutant, you have a shortened tract. But indeed, even in a hypomorphic mutant, which Ashok had shown has intact HR, one sees replication tract shortening, again suggesting a defective response to spalled replication forks in a hypomorphic mutant, potentially analogous to what might occur in a haploinsufficient state, at least consistent with the idea that these functions could be separable. And then turning to BRCA1, working with Li in this case, we used a model of MCF10A, which are non-transformed mammary epithelial cells, where we simply did a heterozygous CRISPR knock-in of the most common full loss of function BRCA1 mutation. And here, although there were not major differences seen in MCF10A with hydroxyurea alone, it's known that the defect could be exacerbated by ATR inhibition. And in this case, with ATR inhibition of the response to the stalled replication fork, he could see further tract lengthening, suggesting that even in the heterozygous state, BRCA1 heterozygous cells were defective in the ATR-mediated function at the stalled replication fork. And along with this, Li has showed that indeed BRCA1 heterozygous cells in the MCF10A model are more sensitive to ATR inhibition. And furthermore, that under these conditions, there is indeed, as we had seen in the heterozygous BRCA2 primary cells, a defect in the checkpoint activation, including phospho-check 1, in this, you know, again, slightly different conditions in the setting of ATR inhibitor. But again, the same sense that there is a haploinsufficient phenotype, that much of it might be focused on events happening related to replication fork protection, and that it might be associated with a defective checkpoint response, and potentially, a vulnerability of these cells to factors required for protection of that fork. So then Li has some other work going on to ask the nature of that protective effect. And here I'm almost reluctant to even present this data in this audience, but with a disclaimer that I know nothing about this field. But what I'd like to tell you, though, is that one of the interesting factors that has emerged is that potentially failed single-strand gap repair could be potentially part of this haploinsufficient phenotype. It's early days, but some of the data go like this. So a recent paper was published in Nature Communications suggesting that in the setting of BRCA2, failed single-strand gap repair may be factor related to actually the sort of subchromosomal losses that we see in the primary cells that I showed you in the very beginning that were shown by the whole genome low pass sequencing. And they were able to show that it was a specific function of BRCA2 related to double-strand DNA binding was required to rescue this phenotype. Here, though, these are experiments in the setting of complete BRCA2 loss, but nonetheless, the idea of this single-strand gap repair being important at the forks. And similarly, Lee has been looking at this in the setting of both homozygous and heterozygous loss of BRCA1 and 2. Now I'm showing you a model that he started on that we've heard about earlier today with the homozygous loss of BRCA1 in ovarian cell, where one can actually reconstitute BRCA1 activity to demonstrate specifically the effects related and dependent on BRCA1. And what you can see is that in the setting of BRCA1 deficiency, PARP is required to prevent degradation of these stalled forks, right? In the setting of PARP inhibitor, that you get fork degradation, newly synthesized tract degradation in the setting of PARP inhibitor. And that particularly in the setting of a PARP inhibitor, this is dramatically exacerbated by ATR inhibition. So ATR required in the setting of a PARP inhibitor to prevent nascent strand degradation, right? And you can see the dependence on BRCA1 here. And then one of the questions Lee is exploring is, what is the nature of what's going on at the fork? He first looked at effects on fork reversal, and here in a relatively complicated experiment of a triple knockdown of factors required for fork reversal, showing that what we're calling the triple knockdown, that in the setting of BRCA1 loss, that the triple knockdown of the fork reversal factors has no impact on the nascent strand degradation in the setting of PARP and ATR inhibition, suggesting that something else other than fork reversal that's happening in this setting. Again, a BRCA1 dependent process. And Lee believes that part of it, again in the BRCA deficient model, part of it relates to single strand gap suppression, because what he can show is that the gaps that occur with PARP and ATR inhibition are substantially, degradation is substantially enhanced by S1 nuclease, which of course degrades the single strand gap. So enhancement, we infer to mean the presence of the single strand gaps in this setting, and all of it BRCA1 dependent, because single strand gaps are not present in the setting of ATR inhibitor with the PARP inhibitor, because there's no difference in the tract length when you use S1 in the presence, when you inhibit ATR in the presence of an intact BRCA1. So the experiments ongoing, of course, are to ask the questions in the heterozygous state and whether we indeed have evidence for failed gap repair in the setting of PARP by itself, and whether ATR is required for gap suppression in the setting in the heterozygous state. So now I'd like to turn to, and that's work that's ongoing, now I'd like to turn to other phenotypes related to transcriptomic profiling of the primary cells. Here you can see a UMAP of all the different cell types that have come out of a single cell RNA-seq from freshly isolated tissues from the mammary glands from the prophylactic mastectomies. And one of the phenotypes that became apparent in this setting was an alteration of immune cells. And here again, more work through one of our great collaborators, in this case, Sean DeMiri, who has a deep interest in the intersection of tumor immunity and breast cancer prevention. Sean's group, initially looking at some of the data we had generated from some of our earlier work with the tissues, suggested that there were actually an increase of CD8 cells in particular in the BRCA2 setting, even greater than BRCA1. And so he has then looked directly at the tissues to follow up some of the data from the single-cell RNA-seq, and has suggested that there are increased immune infiltrates, particularly in the setting of BRCA2, even in the histologically normal tissues. And so Sean has now pursued this in the setting of a mouse model, where he has a heterozygous loss of BRCA2 induced by a K14 Cre, and then, you know, he was trying to mimic a rapid pathogenesis of tumor genesis by estradiol, right, mimicking the stress of hormone exposure, a small dose of radiation to mimic long-term genotoxic stress, and that indeed produces tumors in this setting, and that he can see that even haploid loss of BRCA2 leads to increased immune infiltrates in these tumors. So of course now all the experiments undergoing to ask the question, is this a response to what's going on in the epithelial cells, or could this actually be a driver or even a barrier to malignancy and cancer progression in this setting? And he has now the models and the inbred strains to be able to start answering these questions. So as we're looking at the phenotypes of, again, coming back to these LP cells where we saw this genomic damage, we were looking for transcriptomic signatures through looking at the cohorts of BRCA1 and wild type. And one of the most interesting ones had to do with a set of LP factors that are related to both stress response and growth factor response, hallmarked by increased expression in the BRCA cells of the KIT oncogene. And so the KIT was co-expressed with a number of other factors, some of which we've heard about earlier today, that are enriched in the luminal progenitors of both BRCA 1 and 2, not so much in the wild types. And why was this interesting? Because a number of prior studies had pointed to deregulation of KIT as a hallmark of BRCA early pathogenesis. It's also the case that when we looked at our bulk RNA-seq, because as I mentioned earlier on, we can carry out all this bulk RNA-seq before we started doing single-cell analyses, you could even see this signature inferred through the bulk RNA-seq of luminal progenitors, right? So here's all the genes down here. Here's the BRCA2s. You can see, even in the bulk, you can see the enrichment of this 20-gene signature in the BRCA2s compared to wild types. Again, this is an independent cohort of bulk RNA-seq that essentially validates the type of signature that we had seen from single-cell RNA-seq. Again, I pointed to KIT because a number of studies, a couple of them are mentioned here, a study of more than 10 years old suggesting that indeed in the setting of BRCA1 mutation, one sees an elevated expression of c-KIT, and secondly, that in BRCA mutant models, cells expressing c-KIT have elevated growth and stress responses that lead to deregulation and colony formation, specifically in the c-KIT positive setting. So again, interesting phenotypes, which ultimately are going to give us clues to pathogenesis. And then, the final phenotype that I wanted to mention that I think is going to play an important role here, again, through accumulation of a lot of data from our group and many others, has to do with not only the genotoxic, but the reactive oxygen species and metabolic pathways. So here we had done a series of studies, one of which is shown here, where we tried to overlay what we saw in our MCF10A model. As I told you, that was a CRISPR knock-in, and the primary LP cells from BRCA mutant mammary epithelial tissues, and then look at what are the pathways that seem to be co-enriched. And among the most strongly co-enriched were ROS and UV response pathways. We were particularly intrigued because, for example, our collaborator Ashok Venkatraman had recently published a paper suggesting that BRCA deficiency is actually triggering ROS through a mitochondrial response to oxidative stress. And then even if you take do a simple experiment such as gene set enrichment analysis here in BRCA-associated breast and ovarian tumors, where here you're looking at signature 3 and other BRCA1, 2 mutant per se, one can see differential expression of OxFOS and ROS-related signatures in that context. Again, this is not a proof of cause or effect, but simply a demonstration of a potential phenotype that may reflect the state of the cells, but may give us a handle on pathogenesis and biomarkers. And to further explore whether, in fact, these ROS could be a contributor, we did genome sequencing of these MCF10A BRCA1 CRISPR heterozygous cells. And indeed, in that setting, where the cells recapitulate the ROS signature seen in the primary cells, one could see characteristic mutational features associated with increased oxidative stress, suggesting that indeed this model may recapitulate an oxidative stress response defect that we believe may be present, and secondly, that that defect could contribute to some mutational processes in these cells. And so, you know, thinking about how all of this could contribute is obviously a long process. I think you heard beautiful work from Joan today about systematically dissecting that. All of the collaborators that we're working with are doing that in their own ways, as I've described to you. But I think, you know, as we think about the complex interplay, I think we have really two levels on which to think about it. One is the level of mechanism. What are the early events, and how could they be interfered with, whether it's ROS, whether it's growth factor signaling, whether it's defective replication or dealing with stalled forks, how could those be interfered with at the early stage as potential prevention? But even beyond the level of knowing each step in the pathogenesis and how it works and how to reverse it, some of these phenotypes may be really critical biomarkers of this early cancer predisposition or near-term risk, as I said. One of the ways that we would like to explore that is through the Breast Cancer Atlas, where we're working with a great group funded by the Gray Foundation, Mass General, Jones Group at Harvard Medical School, and Kate Nathanson at UPenn. Our data managers have called us the Ben Collaboration for Brugge, Ellisen, and Nathanson that are working on this to really do a very deep multi-omic dive with many high numbers of samples and using the emerging technologies to understand these phenotypes to get us closer to understanding pathogenesis, but also the biomarkers. One of the major contributors to this atlas from our part is to be able to analyze not only the tissues that we can collect in real time prospectively, but also to take advantage of our extensive archives that we have of patients from the past together with our expert pathology collaborators. And here what we're doing is assembling a large number of tissue microarrays. And again, those of you who have made tissue microarrays, you know, where you core the tumor and then you have a nice microarray. This, it doesn't quite work that way in the setting of normal breast tissue. What the pathologists have to do, and here we're collaborating with Verla Boussier at Mass General, is actually identify individual normal lobules that are then cored for these arrays. And then because of the paucity of the epithelium in the breast, you know, you're doing, 4 to 8 lobules per patient. So it's really quite a complicated endeavor to do this. However, I do believe that if we're thinking about what things can ultimately translate it to the clinic in the near term to help patients and understand their risk and understand pathogenesis, I think that these kind of things where we can rapidly look at high numbers of patients are going to be instrumental to that effort, and that's why we're putting a lot of work into it, besides the fact that the emerging technologies are going to allow us to glean more and more information from a simple core of lobules from breasts of carriers and controls. So just to summarize what I've told you, the subchromosomal aneuploidy is a haploinsufficient phenotype in BRCA1 mutant breast epithelium. That a defective response to replication stress may be haploinsufficient and may contribute indeed to the damage in the absence of an HR defect. That altered ROS production and its response in the setting of BRCA1/2 loss is a likely contributor to cancer progression in the setting. That the role of the immune system as either a response driver, as a response to versus a driver of BRCA1 pathogenesis remains unresolved, but that identifying the biomarkers and identifying the mechanisms really has great promise for our patients to assess near-term risk, prediction, and prevention. So you can understand this is a big collaboration of so many individuals. Particular folks in my lab I'd like to point out is Wen Ren, who's really coordinating tissue collection together with Ilja Schmidt and Isabella Viana. to all of our collaborators with the Gray Foundation, those with the Atlas, as well as Li Zhu, Nadine Tung at Beth Israel Deaconess, Ashok and Sean Demiri, I've mentioned, our computational biology collaborators at the Broad Institute and elsewhere, and our pathology collaborators, and all of the people funding this work. Thanks very much. I'm happy to take any questions.
Hi, very, very interesting. Based on the observation of replication stress in heterozygous cells, do we expect to see any toxicity with ATR inhibitors in heterozygous cells?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I mean, when we do the knock-in of BRCA1, the cells seem to be more sensitive. You know, and I think your question about, you know, toxicity gets to, you know, one of the questions about prevention, right? Will the ideal prevention agent eliminate damaged cells, and is that a good thing, or will it actually potentially lead to repair of damaged cells? I think these are some of the interesting things which we ultimately hope to test in window of opportunity trials, right? And, you know, at some point, Jeff will tell us when ATR inhibitors might be safe enough to do in those trials, right? But I think these are exactly the kind of questions we're looking to answer.
But we might be able to get some insight from our trials where we're treating BRCA carriers with ATR inhibitors. So I don't know, Panos, what do you think? I don't think to date there's real evidence that, for example, there's more bone marrow toxicity in those patients than in patients who are wild type. But it might be that bone marrow progenitors maybe aren't under the same degree of replication.
Well, I think that's it. You know, in the same way that if you think about the mammary gland, we don't see that aneuploidy even in the basal epithelial cells in the gland, right? In other words, it's not so much, you know, an epiphenomenon in every cell that has nothing to do with the fact that you get breast cancer. Really, it's occurring selectively in the cells that are the target for transformation. At least that's what we believe.
Just one follow-up. And then do you think the initial aneuploidy, which, you know, you describe and Joan described, is that what's underlying then this defective ATR-CHK1 response? In other words, why won't the cells have that response?
Yeah.
Or is that what's underlying increased ROS? I mean, so
right. Is
that really the root of it all?
No, exactly.
Aneuploidy?
Yeah, I mean, I think in some ways we were very excited to see that the phenotypes are concordant between the loss of the signaling, right, and the damage, and the, you know, then the failure that you can see in the fiber assays, right? But I think we're still a ways off from putting it all together in terms of the
linear
progression. Yeah.
Where is the reactive oxidative species coming from?
Yeah.
In gynecologic tumors, we have endometriotic cysts, we have hemorrhage there, we have ROS, plenty of ROS there, and that can play a role. But where is that coming from in breast and in early?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, could be different for BRCA1 and 2. You know, Ashok published this paper that he thinks that there's a specific mitochondrial ROS signal coming from BRCA2 that probably is not shared with BRCA1, so they may be distinct in that way.
Yeah, it's very nice, Leif. I like the way you introduced the talk and basically said if you're a BRCA carrier, you know, are you likely to get breast cancer tomorrow or 20 years from now, and so trying to stage the breast tissue, you know, is there a way to, you know, are we at a point where we could take a biopsy of breast tissue and say this is a low stage, there's not a problem here, this is not going to progress, there's not that much replication stress, or this biopsy looks worrisome, this is loaded with replication stress, you better have your mastectomy soon. I don't, you know, is there a way to grade, you know, the level of replication stress, and maybe that would be a pre-cancer initiative?
Well, I think it's one of the things that we can ask in the Atlas, because one of the advantages of the Atlas is we're going to have a mix of patients who had a contralateral mastectomy in the setting of an existing cancer in the other breast, right, and those who had never developed cancer, right? So the idea that if whatever, you know, factors are contributing to the cancer that the patient had, right, to test the hypothesis, is the contralateral breast different in the setting of that, you know, which may be a reflection of all the things that are contributing to the cancer that happened, you know, as compared to a woman who had never had cancer.
It's very smart.
Yeah.
Thank you for your great talk. You mentioned an interesting observation, increase the T cell infiltration in the mutation. So I'm wondering, do you observe the macrophage polarization and the cell-cell interaction change between macrophage and T cell to account for the immune system's role in this subtype?
Yeah, very good question. Macrophages overall are less abundant, and we haven't done a lot of characterization of them yet. Yeah, but they're substantially less abundant than the T cells in that setting. But I think that's exactly one of the next questions. Yeah.
But BRCA deficient breast cancers, BRCA deficient breast cancers, Jen Guerrero has shown that they are macrophage
laden.
So
right.
It might be a real difference between the heterozygous
right.
and the true LOH.
Yeah, I think that's what we're seeing. Yeah, I think that's what we're seeing.
Great talk. Thank you for the talk. So I wonder, in the BRCA2 setting, you're seeing the luminal progenitors being in a high prevalence of then the wild type background, right? I wonder if in presence of ATR inhibitor or any type of PARP inhibitor, what population is the first population you see in your settings that dies first? Is it the mature luminals or the luminal progenitors, you believe, that dies, or the basal cells?
Yeah, it's a good question. We haven't looked at it systematically, right, because a lot of the systems that we do are short-term, where we select for luminal progenitors because we want to isolate the, you know, the effect that's occurring in those. And, you know, that's what we've tested so far. But I think I like your idea of asking the question because, you know, of course, the actual target cell may be somewhat different from the progenitor, might be somewhat more mature, might be acquiring hormone-sensing properties, or be, you know, dysregulated in its phenotype. And I think that's a great question.